In the mid-19th century, on the south shore of Lake Superior, the copper mining business was booming. But the waste from all that mining is threatening Lake Superior's trout and whitefish. Now, scientists and engineers are working to undo the damage.
In the 19th and 20th centuries, immigrants flocked to Michigan's Upper Peninsula to work in copper and iron mines. The Keweenaw Peninsula became known as copper country, and it produced over 7 million metric tons of copper since the mid-1840s. Two copper mines in the towns of Mohawk and Wolverine sent trainloads of rock to mills in Gay, Michigan. There, the rock was crushed and the copper was extracted. The waste rock, known as tailings, or stamp sand, was then dumped into Lake Superior.
As the rock moves through this mill, it's crushed to a smaller and smaller particle, and then it would separate out the sand from the copper. The copper was a heavier weight. And then the sand would be washed out of the mill, and with high volume of water, is sent out as a slurry into Lake Superior.
Before the mills closed in 1932, they generated 22.7 million metric tons of stamp sand. Since then, wind and waves have been moving the stamp sands across the lake bottom and down the shoreline. Robert Regis is a geology professor at Northern Michigan University. His family has been coming to the area since he was a toddler, long enough for him to see dramatic changes.
Probably in the early 70s, we started to see the black stamp sand migrating to this point right here. And every year from there on, the beach got wider and wider and wider. So in 30 to 40 years, the beach has grown to well over 100 meters in width and all of that thickness, which equates to probably about 10 feet per year of, you know, width growth.
The stamp sand is also drifting onto Buffalo Reef, an important spawning ground for fish. These Great Lakes reefs aren't made of coral, they're composed of rocks. And the spaces between those rocks are where spawning trout and whitefish want to drop their eggs.
Lake trout and whitefish that are spawning in this area like very specific habitat. And by that I mean they prefer small cobble substrates about the size of sort of hard balls in terms of a baseball and a softball. Provides protection for incubating eggs, but they're also exposed to nice, cold, well-oxygenated water. And Buffalo Reef is a almost sort of very perfect spawning reef for lake trout and whitefish. And it's been a spawning reef basically since probably Lake Superior was formed roughly 15,000 years ago. And it's also one of the most productive reef habitats in Lake Superior for lake trout and whitefish.
It's estimated that the Buffalo Reef fishery provides $4.5 million of revenue through commercial and recreational fishing every year. But fishermen in the area have already noticed a decline in their catch, and some have had to fish elsewhere. That's partly because the stamp sand can fill in the space between the rocks where fish want to have their eggs, but the sand is also a chemical pollutant.
So it's still, relatively speaking, slightly enriched in copper relative to natural sands. And that sort of dual nature of this material as a contaminant poses two risks to spawning fish. Physical pollutant, it might be clogging up their spawning habitat, but it's also a chemical pollutant, so it might be toxic to the fish.
Charles Kerfoot of Michigan Technological University has been studying the environmental effects of the Upper Peninsula's copper mining history for over a decade.
You have to realize that concentrations of copper are really high. 1,500 parts per million of copper, where the state says 120 can have ecological effects. See, you're dealing with orders of magnitude here.
Dr. Kerfoot and his team collect samples from the lake bottom around the reef.
The jaws come in and scoop up a sample of the sand that's on the bottom, of the sediment that's on the bottom. And then we'll take it back and determine under the microscope how many grains are stamp sand and how many are natural. It's a way for us to calculate copper concentration and potential toxicity.
Dr. Kerfoot has shown a direct link between higher concentrations of stamp sands and fewer benthic organisms. These are the bottom-feeding animals that fish rely on for food.
By 50% stamp sands is very serious effect. By 75%, it's a desert. There's just nothing down there. If nothing is done within 10 years, 60% of Buffalo Reef will be covered by stamp sands.
That would be a disaster for those who depend on the fish of the Buffalo Reef, including the Keweenaw Bay Indian community, which has fought to secure federal funding to clean up Buffalo Reef.
The Keweenaw Bay Indian community is a fishing community. It's part of our identity. The loss of that reef would be devastating to our community. If we lose that one, we'll be losing not only parts of the fish population that are here, but then we're losing all those connections to that area. It's not something that can't be replaced.
Scientists and engineers are racing against the sand and Lake Superior's currents to try to save Buffalo Reef. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers has been working with local environmental scientists to figure out what to do with all the stamp sand. They're exploring several potential permanent solutions, but it will take time to determine which is the most feasible. In the meantime, they need to keep more stamp sand from drifting onto the reef and choking the Big Traverse Harbor.
We're dredging two different areas here in Lake Superior, one at the harbor, the Grand Traverse Harbor, and then the other area we're dredging is a trough, an old drowned riverbed that's adjacent to Buffalo Reef. If we can clear some of that sand out of the trough, the theory is that it'll buy us about 3 to 5 years of time as we develop a long-term solution to the problem.
This has been a big endeavor. As a whole, this is important to everybody. It's been really good to see that so many people consider it to be important and so many agencies consider it important.
It's a lot of energy. We're out here today touring the site. There's a whole group of various stakeholders here from not only the federal government, state government, tribal interests, but the local university, Michigan Technological University. There's a lot of people that have a passion to really, ensure that this site is remediated and that the Buffalo Reef is saved.
We're only stewards of the land. We don't own the land. And other nations within here, the plant, animal, fish nations, they have rights too. And we always have to remember that we're borrowing from the future. And we want to make sure that our children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren have the same opportunities in those relationships and connections that we do.
For more on these stories and the Great Lakes in general, visit greatlakesnow.org. When you get there, you can follow us on social media or subscribe to our newsletter to get updates about our work. See you out on the lakes.